It's time to sit back and check out the RCWR show with Lee Sanders. Get fun, in-depth coverage and analysis from the latest in professional wrestling in AEW, WWE, NWA, Impact Wrestling, or the world of entertainment. From hit TV shows to your favorite sports like the NBA or NFL. All things music, movies, and beyond, while trying to make sense of this crazy world we live in. All while keeping it honest, insightful, and interactive since 2011. And now your hosts, live from the nation's capital of Washington, D.C., Lee Sanders.
Hey, what is good, everybody? Lee Sanders here. You're checking out a new The RCWR Show. I know a lot of you guys, especially those of you that like checking out the webcast editions of The RCWR Show, this may surprise you that you're getting a bonus episode, but I like doing surprises from time to time. So thank you for checking this out for Friday of March 18th, 2022. We're talking about NWA, the Crockett Cup, the 2022 edition of the Crockett Cup, a two-night event that's going to be going down this weekend. It's going to be airing on Fight TV for those of you that can't be there in attendance live. It's going to be airing on Fight TV on both nights, Saturday night and Sunday night. So you'll have the best seat in the house, just like me. I'm actually looking forward to checking out this card. I have been more and more and more really been getting into the NWA. Always love checking out the pay-per-views. Crockett Cup, I'm definitely all in on this. But I got to ask you guys, we'll talk a lot more about the Crockett Cup because I got to show you guys this bracket and we got to try to figure out together who we think is going to be advancing in a lot of these brackets here, who's going to win the whole shebang. But first, I got to ask you guys, did you all check out this week's NWA Power? If you did not, hopefully at the time that you're checking out this episode right now, you have, because I know a lot of you guys aren't doing the monthly subscription for Fight TV or the yearly subscription for Fight TV, so you can check out episodes of NWA when they drop on Tuesdays. I know a lot of you guys are waiting until Fridays when Power episodes are made available. And of course, don't forget Saturdays, you got NWA USA and all. But for those of you that did watch NWA this week, it was a Power Surge episode. And normally we've gotten to a point where when it comes to a Power Surge episode, you just go, okay, I'm actually pretty good. I don't need to watch it because it's just going to be a bunch of rehash. Probably going to see some folks that I normally don't see, matches I don't really care about. But this one, I highly would recommend you go out of your way and check out, because what really made me enjoy this Power Surge episode the most was the fact that it was being presented to us by Joe Galli, Billy Corgan, Talent of Relations, Pat Kenny. And these guys pretty much opened up the show. They kicked it off and they were going over the seeding for the Crockett Cup tournament, and they were going over it in two installments. So we saw them talk for several minutes to open up Power Surge. Then we got some in-ring action. We pretty much went back to them. And it was nice the way that they kept going back and forth. But it really made you feel as though what you were watching during this hour on Power Surge, this is a great, strong go-home edition of Power Surge, as all the attention, all the focus, everything is going on their upcoming pay-per-views this weekend. And I loved it. And it was very up to date. And what do I mean by that? Some announcements that were made that unfortunately did not get covered on prior episodes. of NWA programming. You got a little bit of breaking news. They tried to make it be as current as humanly possible. And you know what? I wouldn't put it past Billy Corgan and them if they had got a little bit of feedback from the fans that were saying, hey, and I know I definitely have been very vocal on recent shows commenting on the fact, for example, what all had went down Trevor Murdoch losing the championship to Matt Cardona. Remember all that? Because it all went down during a special taping of Power Trip. It was Power Trip. You get confused after a while. You got to watch out. But it was during Power Trip, the tapings for that, where Trevor Murdoch lost the NWA championship to Matt Cardona. And the buzz just out of that, people wanted to see how everything had went down, what exactly happened. And you had to wait a few weeks just to be able to see what all had happened. And so I remember my biggest criticism was, hey, we got to try to be as real time as possible if it means we have to start splicing stuff in so that folks can have the most updated knowledge about what all is going on, feel as though what they're checking out is very, very fresh, then okay, great. So it was nice to see that some of these breaking pieces of news as far as who was going to be in the tournament, who's going to be teaming up with who, it was nice to see that type of information get relayed so that we all had the most up-to-date information going into the Crockett Cup within reason. Because, you know, after all, card is subject to change for a lot of these wrestling promotions, but I still appreciate that great gesture by them. But so much great emphasis put on this event. I love this on so many levels, and I think this needs to be the blueprint that Nick Aldis, Billy Corgan, and crew need to go with going forward, making sure that the most accurate, up-to-date information is available on these final Power Surge episodes when they're going into these pay-per-views. So welcome breath of fresh air. And then also, not to mention, it's awesome that we get to hear from Billy Corgan, because it's very rare that we hear from him. And I don't mind the fact that he's mainly behind the scenes. And you know that when you do see him on NWA programming, it's a big deal. So I love the fact that there is some seriousness. Okay, it's all about business right here when you do see him on screen and everything. But I really loved his chemistry with Joe and Pat, just going back and forth, helping fans understand the selections with a lot of these names we're seeing in this tournament. And also talking about strengths, somewhat weaknesses from some of these teams in the tournament, being brutally honest with their perspectives, with their critique. I loved it. I freaking loved it on so many levels here that I just was into this the entire time. So I definitely would recommend you guys go out of your way and check it out. I gave those guys many props on social media when the episode was over and done with, and quite a few people on the NWA roster showed what I had posted a lot of love, retweeted it, shared it and everything. And what I had said exactly, I said, ah, oh, silky, silky now. Now that is how you close out a go-home show for an upcoming pay-per-view. Good job, boys. And it was. It truly was a fantastic job. In-ring action-wise, it really wasn't about the in-ring action on this episode of NWA Power. Not to do a full-blown recap, but for those of you that maybe want to get my thoughts on a couple of the matches that had played out on this episode of Power Surge, Jay Spade got a victory over Saul Renaro. That honestly went as expected, as Saul Renaro is continuing to go down this mental downward spiral of just having no mental capacity whatsoever, as he is just going further and further down this rabbit hole of darkness. And I just can't help but think, okay, are we going to get to that point where we're going to see Danny Deals eventually say, you know what, man, this dude is just too crazy for me. He's too out there. He is officially not the same guy that I was coming up with. I don't want anything else to do with him. I truly believe that in order for Saul Renaro's venture to the dark side to be fully complete, he eventually has to attack Danny Deal. Sorry, Danny. I love you, brother. I love you. I know Danny Deals once in a while will check out the show and show me some love on social media and all that. I got to interact with him a lot more, by the way. But yeah, I think in order to really put that nail on the coffin and everything, you got to do something along those lines. But is an action like that going to be enough where Saul is going to be able to have the good graces of the sinister minister and the father James Mitchell and be able to join up also there with Judas? Only time is really going to tell. So after that little opener of a match for Power Surge. Also, Billy Corgan in a one-on-one conversation with Joe Galli had revealed that due to the injuries Trevor Murdoch sustained in his match against Matt Cardona during those Power Trip tapings, he would not be able to compete in the Crockett Cup. So he ultimately was replaced by Nick Aldis. And as we all know, Nick Aldis has decided he wants to punch in his opportunity to go after the NWA 10 pounds of gold, as he's going to be facing Matt Cardona there. More on that in just a hot minute. But I loved hearing Billy Corgan talk about the previous world champion there and Trevor Murdoch, and, you know, basically saying, you know, this is very unfortunate. I could have called the match. I could have easily, but that's why we have officials, EMTs. You know, they pretty much will make the right decision. They'll make the right call. So I felt that Trevor Murdoch was really in good hands. You know, it's unfortunate. And, you know, he actually, to a degree, defended Matt Cardona as far as his stance on, you know, how he sees the NWA and, you know, what all they're doing wrong and how they essentially need to, you know, go about the future and everything. Billy Corgan met Matt Cardona to a certain point in understanding Cardona's philosophy and everything. And, you know, not to kind of go back and forth and just go all over the place, but, you know, very good interview that Billy Corgan had gave recently as he chatted it up with the guys over at My Mom's Basement. Check them out. It was actually a pretty good joint. And he talked about the success of NWA Power. He said, I think it is in the general neighborhood of what I started out to do, but I've had to adjust. One thing, of course, was the success of Power. A lot of people didn't think Power would work. It did work, and it continues to work. The whole idea with Power was to be a little more 21st century, of the moment, social media, and have surprises, and kind of, fun isn't the right word, but have a little bit of a wink to it, but not be overly serious. But because of the way things have lined up, Power has had to be our flagship program as opposed to a sort of standard traditional program that you would see from everybody else. So it's had to stress test what would Power represents. Yeah, it sounds kind of funky here. I'll try it again. So it's had to do a stress test to see what Power would represent. There you go. I clean it up a little bit better. Yeah, transcript's a little bit funky here. So Power is kind of an amalgam of what I want it to be versus what it needs to be. And he also commented on NWA as a promotion of opportunity to kind of mirror in there Matt Cardona and all the recent stuff that's been going on with his involvement in the promotion. As far as the rest of the product, I think we're finally now in this kind of fifth year pivoting towards what I want the NWA to be in the 21st century. It's a lot easier to talk about than accomplish because, first of all, you have to build a culture. So when you have a Harry Smith, who I do go back, like I said, 10 years with, I still have to be able to point to and say, look, this is what the NWA represents. Do you fit into this or don't you? that oftentimes is a bigger selling point than how much and how long. It's become more about the passion and why people do what they do in the business. A lot of people that we work with really feel that the business hasn't given them the fairest opportunity. So part of what we need to do is create an environment that says, look, you'll have an opportunity to rise to the top. In NWA, nothing will stop you. I think if you look at the diversity of our roster, the different backgrounds that people come from on every level, including internationally, I think you see that it is really a company of opportunity. Exactly. And I think that's why so many people don't mind working with Billy, Nick Aldis, and the NWA, because they truly see that it is a place of opportunity. Whatever was going on at another promotion, that's pretty much irrelevant. You know, it is pretty much a clean slate. The only way you won't get an opportunity in the NWA is if maybe you've been involved in some really, really taboo, really jacked up, controversial, we don't want nothing to do with you because we don't want that stank on us. You feel where I'm coming from? So to his point, yeah, and when you see guys such as Matt Cardona or the Briscoes even, JTG, Dirty Dango, I mean, we'd be here, La Rebellion, you see these guys that are coming in and wanting to work with the NWA. It's a beautiful thing because not only are they helping out the NWA, but they are also, really helping, I personally feel, in redefining and laying down a new legacy of the NWA. Because let's be honest, there was a significant period of time for a couple of decades there where NWA was just... Let's be honest. So what they're doing right now is pretty badass, I must say personally. Continuing on, as far as in-ring action, Allison Kay defeated Missa Kate. Actually was a nice little kind of, I was surprised this actually wasn't a squash match. I'll say that much. I was surprised that this wasn't a squash match. And let's not forget, Missa Kate, she had took on Kylie Rae. If you guys recall, Kylie Rae, she had took her on. It was basically Chicago Girl versus Chicago Girl. I can't think of the pay-per-view right now, or maybe it was an episode of Power. Billy Corgan, Pat and Joe, they went over the rest of the Crockett Cup. Fixers got in a nice little talking spot of an interview as well. Judias got a squash win over Jamie Stanley. And wrapping up the Superpower edition for this week, Nick Aldis confronting Matt Cardona, really going home, selling that main event match for the pay-per-view. Loved it. We'll go into the match card for Crockett Cup predictions and all that right now. Let's go ahead and let's do it on that note. But a good episode of Power. If anything, look, if you're not really a fan of some of the matches that I just mentioned, at least go out of your way to check it out just so you can see Pat, Joe, and Billy go over to Crockett Cup. You'll thank me later, trust me. So in regards to the Crockett Cup, let's go ahead and let's go there. Let's talk a little bit about this card here. And I've actually got the bracket up, so you guys are going to be seeing it for our audio listeners. I'll be going over the seeding here and who all is going to advance and whatnot. So actually, I want to blow up a bigger image for me so that I can do this properly right with you guys here. So bear with me a second here, and now I am good to go. All right, so this is how your Crockett Cup is looking here for these teams. So let's start with the far right side first. So as you guys can see, we got the OGK. They have faced the Fixers, and pretty much by default, Fixers were able to advance. So, you got to keep in mind, though, when you look at the other side there, there's a play-in. There's a play-in joint. And the way that that basically is going to be going down, I believe it's a total of four teams. I believe it's four teams that's going to be fighting each other. And whichever team comes out of that victorious, they'll be able to get the number 16 play-in spot, but they're going to be facing La Rebellion, which is the number one seed, right? So kind of keep that in mind. But I bring that up to ask the question, is it possible that OGK may get another opportunity by going into that play-in match, right? Well, by having the match to then go into the play-in match, is it possible they may be put in there? We'll have to wait and see. The Cardonas, that basically consists of Mike Knox and who's the other guy? Let me actually pull up his name. The other guy I'm thinking of is, hang on. let me look here. That would be VSK. VSK. So the Cardonas are going to be going up against Pulp and Mims. I would like to see Pulp and Mims get some type of a revenge on the Cardonas here, man. Pulp alone, because he still essentially has a receipt he needs to cash in on everything that had came about. Remember when he legit got a concussion and everything a couple of months back? It's too close to call. It's too close to call, but I'm going to say Pulp and Mims get the W there. We got Aaron Stevens and Kratos. They're going to be teaming up in the seventh seed as they're going to be facing at 10th seed, the Dirty Sexy Boys, Dirty Dango and JTG. How can I pick against the Dirty Sexy Boys, man? I got Dirty Sexy Boys over Kratos and Stevens. We've got the Now. The Now are going to be going up against the Briscoe Brothers. You heard me right. The Briscoe Brothers, they're going to be there, yo. Oh, I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to that. The Now, Hell Collins and Vic Dalcius. I am going to say the Briscoes. I'm going to say the Briscoes. So looking at that respected side, that far right side, I'm trying to think. Yeah, for you guys, it's going to be your far right side as well. So keeping that in mind, let's look at the next round for that side. So as we already know, the Fixers, they had advanced automatically. So having this laid out as Fixers going up against Pulp and Mims, I am going to say Pulp and Mims will advance there. And then we already said Dirty Sexy Boys would advance. So Dirty Sexy Boys, we got them advancing. So Dirty Sexy Boys against Briscoes. I gotta go with, oh man, this is a tough one. This is a tough one. I'm gonna go with Briscoes. Seriously, especially if you want to create some buzz going into the second night and all that. I'm going to go with Briscoes. So that brings it down for that respected side. Briscoes against Pulp and Mims, right? Briscoes and against Pulp and Mims, if I'm looking at this right. Yeah, hang on. Well, hang on. I might be looking at this wrong. Hang on. Because I said Fixers, Pulp Mims, or Pulp Mims, and then Briscoes. Yeah, no, I am doing it right. I am doing it right. I'm going to say Briscoes will go into the finals. I'm going with the Briscoes into the finals. Let's look at the far left side now. We've got La Rebellion, BSCS666, and Mecha Wolf. Remember, they're going to be facing whoever wins that play-in. So keeping that in mind, So we don't know who all is supposed to be part of that play-in. And see, currently, they are your NWA tag champions. So I'm going to say La Rebellion advances. Hawks Airy, they're going up against The End, Pharaoh, and my boy Otison. Oh, man, I love The End. I do not want to pick against The End. Jesus, I'm going to go with... I am going to go with... I'm going to go with an upset here. I'm going to say Hawks Airy for the W. I'm going to say Hawks Airy. Strictly Business, Chris Adonis and Tom Latimer. They're going to be going up against Gold Rush. That consists of Jordan Clearwater, Marche Rocket. I'm going with Strictly Business. Nothing personal, boys. The Ill Begotten. We don't know which members of Ill Begotten will be representing for this tag match, but they'll be facing Doug Williams. It'll be Doug Williams and Harry Smith. Yes, Harry Smith is in this bad boy. Late addition, as it was covered on Power Surge. I'm going to go with Williams and Smith. Anytime we've got Harry Smith involved in a tournament, I don't really like picking against him, yo. So I'm going to go with Harry Smith. Okay, now, continuing on. Remember I said La Rebellion would advance. So they basically are going to be facing Hawks Airy. Yeah, Hawks Airy. I'm going to say Hawks Airy. Yet again, I'm going to go with Hawks Airy. And then Strictly Business will be going up against, if I'm looking at this right, Strictly Business, they will be going up against Williams and Smith. I am going to go with Williams and Smith. Yeah, I'm going to go with Williams and Smith. So that pretty much has it come down to Hawks Airy going up against Williams and Smith. I'm going to go with Williams and Smith. So the way I'm looking at this at the very end, it is going to be Doug Williams, Harry Smith against the Briscoe brothers. I mean, that is a very interesting matchup, is it not? The way I'm laying this out, that would be a very, very interesting matchup. If you weren't to go in that direction, I still feel that it's going to be Briscoe's definitely at the end there. But if you're not going to go with Doug Williams and Harry Smith, then is it possible that maybe whoever is in that 16th seed could go all the way there to the finals? Is that even remotely possible? Talk about a true underdog there, but that could also happen. So you got two scenarios there, but I'm going to say to win it all, the Crockett Cup and all that, I am going to go with, man, that's a tough one. Seriously, that is a tough one. I'm going to go with Doug Williams and Harry Smith to win the Crockett Cup. I'm going to go with them to win the whole thing. That's the team I'm going to be going with. Now, whether or not it's going to pan out that way, we'll see what happens. Let me know you guys' thoughts. I'm very curious how you guys are seeing it with your respected brackets there. All right. Meanwhile, we got some more matches that's going to be going down. So it's safe to say that night one is going to be all about tag team action, but then the winners will face each other, you know, like in the finals. I would imagine that the finalists will face each other on night two. I mean, that's the way I would kind of set this up. But if they're going to crown the tag champions on night one, that's fine as well, honestly. And by the way, new information as far as that four-way tag team match for the winner to go into the play-in. Here's your participants. Violence is Forever's Dominic Guarini and Kevin Koo versus the Bad News Boys, Brandon Tate and Brent Tate, versus the Rip City Shooters, Joshua Bishop and Wes Barkley, and the Heat Seekers, Elliot Russell and Sigmund. Yeah, I'm not seeing any of these. Yeah, 16th seed, you can forget about it. You can forget about that 16th seed. As far as who could possibly win from that Fatal 4-Way to go into the play-in match at the 16th seed, I have no idea. I'll go with the Rip City Shooters. I'm just going to pick one at random because I'm not really that familiar with a lot of these names, honestly. For this particular match, I'm not familiar with a lot of these names. All right, so that all is pretty much covering night one. Night two, it's all about our champions, as the Hex, Allison Kay, and Marty Bell will be defending the NWA Women's Tag Champions against Pretty Empowered. That consists of Ella Envy and Kenzie Page. Kenzie Page, by the way, has been doing a phenomenal job in slimming down within recent weeks. I got to give her a lot of freaking props. Whatever that sister is doing, she is doing it well, man. A lot of mad props to her. I don't see the NWA Women's Tag Championship here, the reign of the Hex, threatened in any type of way. I've got them continuing to be your NWA Women's Tag Champion. But that should be a pretty decent matchup. Anthony Mayweather, remember, he recently became the new NWA National Champion. You saw that a couple of weeks back on a Power Trip episode there. He's going to be defending the championship against Jax Dane, the Dane event there. This match I would watch out for, because some shenanigans could go down in a way where Anthony Mayweather successfully defends the championship, but yeah, it's a pain in the you-know-what to get out of there as the champion. And maybe something could come about where maybe somebody runs a little bit of interference. I don't know if maybe from Idolmania's camp, Jax Dane has an opportunity to kind of recover a little bit, and then he decides to cash in his championship opportunity right there on the spot, takes advantage of a weakened Anthony Mayweather, and pretty much becomes your new NWA National Champion. Something to seriously think about. If I really wanted to create some buzz and all of that, I definitely would go in that respected direction, because last I checked, and you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe Jax Dane still has his championship opportunity here. So just when we thought we were done with this respected feud, here we are yet again with both of these guys going at it here. So I'm going to say Mayweather retains. Remember, as of late, he's been in storyline in this new position where it's a new Anthony Mayweather. It's Anthony Mayweather that, you know, he's trying to take himself more seriously, take his work more seriously. Was pretty hard on himself after that pep talk he received from Nick Aldis some weeks back on NWA USA. Right, it's time to start cashing in on those W's, because the L's, you know, that don't pay the bills, basically. So I'm going to say Anthony Mayweather retains, but keep your eyes peeled. There could be some shenanigans that could go down in this matchup. Tyrus defends the NWA World Television title against Rodney Mack. Rodney Mack, this is so freaking random. It really is, because remember, one of the last times that we saw Rodney Mack, remember, we saw him, wasn't it against Jax Dane, as a matter of fact? Was it Jax Dane that was putting down all the Hall of Famers that were showing up and everything, and he took a nice little jab at Jazz, and then you had freaking Rodney Mack come out and pretty much push Jax Dane on his ass. Now, see, if you would have done Rodney Mack versus Jax Dane, okay, I'd be more, because I remember I came on the show afterwards and I said to you guys, yo, can we see the return of the Rodney Boy White Boy Challenge? I know you guys remember that. So if not remember me saying that, I know a lot of you guys remember the White Boy Challenge. So this just feels so freaking random to me on so many levels. I don't see the NWA TV title here threatened in any type of way. My question is, what championship defense would this be? Because I'm looking at Tyrus here. Give me a second here. Television champion, right? Let's see here. Tyrus. I want to see how many times Tyrus has defended this championship. I think this would be number 6. So bear with me a second here, because this is either going to be number 6 or it's going to be number 7. Okay, here we go. I'm looking at his match history right now.
see. Survey says, okay, so he got one retain over Jaden Rawler. He got another retain over Sion. He got another retain over Jordan Clearwater. He got another retain over Black G's. He got a, well, he first won it by defeating Pulp. So let's remember that. He first won it by defeating Pulp. So Black G's, Jordan Clearwater, Sion, Jaden Roller. So this would actually be number five. This would be title defense number five for Tyrus. We sure it's not number six? Because it seems like he did something with Sion recently. I could be wrong. Let me just look here. It seems as though he did something with Sion recently. Hang on. Let me just cross-reference real quick. I could be wrong. I could be wrong. Let me just look here real quick. Let me see here. Okay, so one against Sion. One against Pulp. Let me look here. This looks like, hang on. This was for the TV title. Give me all the joints with the TV title. Yeah, the other guys that I'm looking at, they are not accurate enough here. All right, I see one against Sion. Let's go to 2022. Okay. Yeah, these guys aren't, nah, these guys aren't. All right, so it looks like this would be number five. This would be number five for him. So, and he's been champion for somewhere between 284 days or maybe 282 days at the time that we're doing this right now for you guys. So, yeah, I don't see the championship reign of Tyrus ending right here. Very random, though. Camille defends the NWA World Women's Championship, the Burke, against Chelsea Green. Oh, it's a triple threat match, by the way. As Kylie Rae supposedly is going to be in this match as well. Are we sure about that? Because, you know, knocking on wood for that girl, but she's always having some type of personal setbacks that's going on. Are we even sure that she's going to be able to make it to this one? But hey, look, I give NWA a lot of credit here. At least they're trying to make it interesting and they're doing a triple threat match. But honestly, this feels so freaking random. This is a match right here that really should be mirroring up to what we've been seeing recently play out on television. I think, honestly, somehow, some way, they should have gone down in a fashion where Natalia Markova somehow slides her way into an opportunity to face Camille for the championship. The fact that Kylie Rae is involved in this, that is just, if this holds up, that is just so freaking random and just so, especially when you look at everything that's been going on with the Chelsea Green character as well. No, on so many levels, this is just, where's Melina, right? I could understand, if you're going to do a triple threat, it makes more sense to have Melina in there and Natalia Markova in there. Capitalize on the fact that Natalia Markova, she's been successfully defending that HOG Women's Championship and everything. I don't see, despite these other names that's in here, this is another case right here where I don't feel a real threat to Camille in any type of way here. I mean, if you really wanted to make this truly interesting, you know, have a little bit of interference come about, some shenanigans come about there from Natalia Markova. Maybe you inject Mae Valentine in the process and all that. That would be kind of right. But Camille retaining. Austin Aries in action as he is going up against Homicide, Darius Lockhart, and Colby Carino. Remember, this is a four-way match for the vacant NWA World Junior Heavyweight Championship. These are your final four right here. Two names I'm looking at that's just screaming loudly at me right now. I'm looking at Colby Carino, and I'm looking at Austin Aries. Now, isn't Austin Aries part of that new Control Your Narrative promotion thingamajigga? Because I'm actually looking that up right now. I believe he's involved. Yeah, he's going to be involved with it. Matter of fact, isn't he like one of the owners or whatever, co-owners or something like that? Those two names really scream out to me. Austin Aries does have the name recognition, and you know, people are always talking. He always manages to get people talking about him. I don't know, guys. This is a tough one. This is a tough one. And the thing that we have to keep in mind is that whoever this NWA World Junior Heavyweight Champion is going to be, we're mainly going to be seeing them on NWA USA. That's the main thing that we got to keep in mind. I am going to go with Colby Carino. I gotta, you know, all that hard work that kid has been putting in, the way he's been able to just turn his life, you know, all around. And I mean, every single time I'm seeing this kid, he is getting better and better by the match here, man. I just, you gotta ride with that. You gotta ride with that kid. You gotta reward him for all that dedicated hard work he's continuing to put in, day out. Surprisingly, Nick Aldis, nowhere to be found defending his respected championship here. He's getting a rare night off here. Yeah, it looks like he's not defending his championship. What's up with that? What's up with that? Okay, it is what it is. Matt Cardona defending the 10 pounds of gold against Nick Aldis. Singles match for the World Heavyweight Championship. Jeff Jarrett will serve as a special guest referee. You know, if you really wanted to make this interesting, by the way, I'm going with Matt Cardona for the retain, so you guys know. Let me get that out the way off the break. But if you wanted to make this extremely interesting, I would just love to see Jeff Jarrett screw the hell out of Nick Aldis. And you got enough of a blueprint where you could basically borrow a lot of elements from their time in TNA. You can actually say something along the lines of, you know, Jeff and Matt Cardona, you know, they're actually very good friends. Turns out, you know, they go a few years back, and right, you know, we're talking about two guys that did stuff for the GCW promotion and all that now. So I personally would love to see Jeff Jarrett. And we know he's going to be giving a speech and all of that Crockett Cup weekend, but you really want to build some buzz and do some badass shit and do something in such a way where Nick Aldis, okay, more on Matt Cardona later. Right now, you got some business to take care of with Jeff Jarrett, right? And then coming from out of that, Aldis, Jarrett, just to, you know, see them go, I would love to see that. I don't know exactly what's going on with Jeff Jarrett's schedule for the next couple of weeks, but yo, if they can iron out the details, if that money is just right, you know, work out whatever kinks they need to work out, I personally would love to see that in the NWA. I don't know about you guys, but they would benefit tremendously from working with Jeff Jarrett for the next hot little bit. So that's the way that I pretty much would set this up, and you pretty much in that pay-per-view. Hopefully debris is being thrown into the ring, but you got Cardona, Big Mike Knox, VSK, Chelsea Green, Jeff Jarrett all standing strong and tall, and you know, it pretty much is kind of ending almost like NWO, if you will. And that should be a great emotional night as well, all things considered. Scott Hall and everything. So but that's how I would end it. That's how I would go about this match. So we'll see, because right now, All right, so you have Nick Aldis sidelined. So you have him sidelined, and depending on what's going on with Trevor Murdoch, you know, maybe you can reactivate him, bring him into the mix. Or let's not forget, Pulp has a championship cash-in opportunity. Does Pulp come out of this whole two-night event, tries to cash in the championship opportunity on Matt Cardona next? Because you need somebody that can automatically, right, you got to plug and play. So do you maybe notice I had him and Mims advancing, but so far in the tournament there? So a lot to think about. But for night two, once again, I'm looking at, man, a lot of these I got retains. Yeah, I'm just not convinced. The one match I would put an asterisk by and say a swerve could be coming is the NWA National Championship. But I've got, oh, and forgive me, by the way. I said, where was Chris Adonis? No, the national champ, yeah. Anthony Mayweather defeat Chris Adonis there for the title. I don't know why, like, forgive me for that, guys. Point thing is, I caught it now. Hex, I got them retaining the NWA Women's Tag Titles. Mayweather retaining the NWA National Championship, although I like that idea that I mentioned earlier, so look out for that. Tyrus retains his NWA World TV title over Rodney Mack. Camille retaining her NWA Women's Championship, the Burke, against Kylie Rae and Chelsea Green in a triple threat. Very close to call, but I'm going with Colby Carino to become your new NWA World Junior Heavyweight Champion. Main event match, Matt Cardona retaining the NWA Heavyweight Championship. That's how I'm looking at this great weekend of NWA action known as Crockett Cup. Once again, if you guys aren't going to be able to check out the events live in person, as it'll be happening in Nashville, Tennessee at the Nashville Fairgrounds, you got the next best thing. You can check it out on Fight TV. Get the bundle deal so you get a little bit of a discount. I will be covering, at this point, I'm going to put a poll out for you guys. You'll see that poll out right now, at the time that I'm speaking right now. You'll see a poll that'll be available. I pretty much have made that poll be available all day Friday, but I want to know, or actually the poll has been available since Thursday afternoon. I want to know if you guys want me to come on both nights, or if you want me to just do one post show on Sunday night. So you guys could definitely sound off and let me know, and whatever the winning majority is, that's how we'll pretty much go about the shows for Crockett Cup weekend. Hey, be kind, rewind, check out previous episodes of the RCWR show you might have missed on demand and on the downloads wherever you get your podcasts. And if you made it up to this point, if you have not done so already, it only takes 2 seconds and it's free. Kindly smash that like button. When you do that, you really help out big time. Shout out to those of you that check out our webcast episodes via YouTube. Yeah, when you smash that like button, you're letting the YouTube algorithm team know how much you had enjoyed this episode, and it helps them out even more as far as content recommendations go. So as far as helping grow our community even more, you're doing your part. I'm doing my part, showing up, doing what I do best. You guys doing your part by smashing that like. It's a win-win for us all and this great community that we have with each other here. So do that, and thanks in advance. And also feel free to subscribe so you never miss out on future content that comes your way. As long as you got the notifications on, you'll never miss out. You can get at me on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Use the keywords The RCWR Show. And until Crockett Cup post-show fallout weekend, I'm wishing all of you all to be safe. And most importantly, be kind to one another. I will see you guys next go-round. Adios, y'all. Take care.